Okay, so welcome to another episode of the Cardano Artist Corner Vodcast. Today we meet Agnes van Gaalen, or in English, Agnes van Gaalen, something like this. Agnes is a painter slash jewelry maker slash fashion designer slash singer. And she's a Dutch painter, artist, and she lives in the heart of France. So Agnes, with her husband Bas, we might see later. So Agnes, welcome to the podcast.
Thank you very much, Alfred. Nice to see you again.
Yeah, it's nice to see you again. So like we say in Holland, to fall with the door in the house. Where did you learn to paint? What did you go to art school? Or what is the
story? I did go to art school in Holland when I was 17 years old. Mm-hmm. So I was there for 4 years. And that's how it started. But it started before art school, mm-hmm. When I was younger. I went to a group of artists, amateurs. And I was first a model when I was 15. Oh. Then I could see all the painters from another perspective.
Right.
And when I was 16, I could paint with them. So I learned a lot over there. And that was a good start for the art school later on.
Did you know that you would like to paint when you were a model? Or did you discover it when you were a model?
As a child, I was always in my room and painting and designing and redecorating my room. And, it was one of the first things I discovered about myself.
Right. Okay. That you had an artistic inclination. But I read that you also, you were doing maybe an apprenticeship, or you also learned from a painter called Bill Parks in New Zealand.
New Zealand.
Yes.
Yeah, because
who is Bill Parks?
Bill Parks is a very good artist in aquarelle. And he was already at age, like in his, I think, beginning of 70s. And I met him at a quarry in Whangarei in New Zealand. Mm-hmm. And the quarry is a real quarry, but abandoned and adopted by artists.
Oh, wow.
So you could hire, like for instance, a little bungalow to stay there as an artist in residence. And we were there by boat. So you went to Whangarei, and then you suddenly see this opening. It's not a wide opening, a small opening to the quarry. And then you have this beautiful arena. And then with all the art and the little houses made out of wood. And I was there for a month. So, and that's where I met him, and I started to paint with him.
But what is interesting is that many people that I meet, artists, they study to be one thing, and then they go after their education, they do something else. Because, I mean, you did not straight away become a painter because you became a singer, right?
Yeah. So. Well, almost everything happens accidentally in my life. Mm-hmm. I like a lot of things. And so when it comes on your way, my ex-husband was a musician, but when I just met him, he was a bass player. He said, we need a backing vocal and a singer in the band. So maybe it's something for you. Just come and have a look at the rehearsal, and we will test your voice. So that's what I did. And I thought, oh, that's great.
So you actually didn't know that you could sing.
Yeah, I knew I had a nice voice, but it was like a proposal I couldn't resist.
Yeah. An offer you couldn't refuse, yeah. And actually, you were in some of the bands. I saw the names of the bands, and one I remember very well because they were quite famous in Holland. It's the Margriet S-House band.
Yeah.
And I recall the name because that one hit single called House of Flames, right?
No, House for Sale. Yeah. House for Sale.
No, I just had a lapse. I just watched the video. So,
yeah.
House for Sale. You can.
So when you were a singer, this is where you met your husband, Bas. Is that correct?
It was like, so I was in several bands with my first husband. And then I was in the Margriet S-House band.
Mm-hmm.
And I was single again, living mm-hmm. on my own in an apartment. And that's how I met Bas mm-hmm. in the apartment, because it was in the same building. We were neighbors.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Because I know that Bas is in the same room. He's sitting on the couch. Can we just get Bas? Can we get Bas on the screen for 1 minute and get his version?
Come, love.
Hello. Hi there.
Bas. No,
my lovely lady.
Yes. Because I thought maybe you saw Agnes singing on the stage, you saw this Dutch angel, and then you went to the concert and then you fell in love. Or I mean, yes, what really happened? What is the real story?
That's about the real story.
Yeah, that's the real story.
Yeah.
But the other one is I saw her a few times, also in discos and bars, and
yeah.
And I thought, oh, wow. And then suddenly she became my neighbor. And then, so we met, and it didn't take too long before we went for a day, you know, driving. Yeah. I said, so shall we go to Amsterdam for a day? Mm-hmm. You know, living in the South. Oh, we did that. And then a few, I think a week later or so, we went to Germany. And then since then, that's 35 years ago. So
yeah.
Yes.
And he said, well, maybe I can live in your apartment. And I said, no way.
Oh, sure.
That was my first reaction.
Mm-hmm.
But then he said, well, I have already some stuff here. And if it's not working, I can go back to my apartment. So mm-hmm. I looked at him very seriously. So you're not kidding, I said. You're serious about this? He said, yes. I said, okay.
Oh, well.
Let's do it.
Yes. Never left.
Yeah.
Never left. Well, easygoing Holland in the 70s or the 60s or whenever it was. Bas, I can see lots of paintings behind you guys. I presume they are the paintings of Agnes.
Yes, that's
maybe
right.
We can use Bas so we can... Agnes, yeah. if you wanna tell the paintings... Describe the paintings, and then Bas can walk to them and he can point at them.
Yeah, okay. This one, yeah. So, you know, I have different styles and mm-hmm. I'm always working in series.
Mm-hmm.
So this is a series like, it's called Signs and Symbols.
Mm-hmm.
So symbols from all over the world I combined with like aquarelle and acrylic paint.
This is a painting. This is a painting or a different material.
Painting, but it's, you know, I put the paper on the ground and I smash some mm-hmm. acrylic paint on it.
Because it almost looks, now it looks different because it almost looked three-dimensional.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And then afterwards, so the red part I did first. You mm-hmm. see this this one. So all the red I did first, and then I made it myself very difficult because mm-hmm. I worked underneath with aquarelle paint
uh-huh.
and ink. So,
sounds
you
complex.
Yeah, very complex.
You can see the ink.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Because through our travels, I was really inspired by all the symbols everywhere of the people on their houses.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because you guys traveled all over the world, right?
Yeah.
This is another example.
This from the same series. Mm-hmm. So all the green is like very quickly done with acrylic. Let me guess,
this was made in Indonesia or Thailand or not?
It's inspired by Indonesia. Yeah.
Mm.
These turn into beautiful NFTs.
We'll talk about that later.
But the story is also like when we were traveling, I was painting in a very small size. Now, this is on handmade paper.
Oh, that's beautiful.
Yeah.
What is it called?
This is a series of flowers, really, and it doesn't have a title. As a series.
Uh-huh.
But I love the structure of paper, and that's what I saw also in New Zealand, because they made a paper of grass.
Of grass.
Grass. And I bought that kind of paper to paint on.
You mean like the Egyptians? Or not?
Yes, yeah. Iris. But yeah. That's a different type of this. Yeah.
Yeah.
So this is like a combination already of paint, oil paint, and lace. So this is where the textile comes in. And this is Lokta paper.
Mm-hmm.
And Lokta paper is from the Himalaya. And this is handmade.
From Nepal?
Yeah, from Nepal.
Mm-hmm. Also beautiful.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
So slowly, while traveling, I only could paint on a small size.
Mm-hmm.
And through Bill Parks, I met this technique, wash and line. So it's like aquarelle and ink.
Mm-hmm.
And then later on, when I had my studio, I was combining old wallpaper with handmade paper, with textile, old lace here in France.
So different materials.
Yeah, all kinds of different materials. So mixed media. And I really like to mixed work media. With textile and mixed media, and also with like oil paint. And oil paint is what you see behind me. Just the small
Maybe one. We can get Bas to show us one painting from nearby.
Yeah, the little one. So a plein air painting.
Mm-hmm.
So you go out, and especially here we are living next to the river Loire.
Mm-hmm.
And there is Sancerre, Pouilly, all the vineyards. So and then you're outside in the wind. You can hear the birds singing.
Yeah, it's lovely.
Yeah, then you make a painting in one day.
Oh, right. Okay.
It's very very tiring because of the concentration.
Yes.
Because, you know, the light is changing.
Because you have to. Yeah, because you have to finish it in that moment, I guess.
Yeah, you have to remember. The moment you start painting, how the sun is. So this is Pouilly. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, there are all kind of subjects in nature.
I have questions I wanted to ask you to describe three other artworks. Oh, I cannot see myself. Three other artworks. One is called Reflection. So what is the story behind reflection? It's like a flower or a tree that is shines onto the river, and then you see the reflection inside the...
That's the one you see over there.
Yes, exactly.
I will ask Bas to,
yes,
to bring it, mm-hmm, to us. Yeah, I was, it's a photo of a photographer we know very well, a lovely lady, and she made a series of photos of flowers, forest, mm-hmm, fields, and it's the reflection here is like, where does the real world, mm-hmm, end?
And the reflection starts. The
reflection starts. Mm. So, and it was very hard to do because, you know, it's. I was intrigued by the subject. Mm. But then again, you can lose yourself in a painting.
Yeah.
And because you dive in, but you know, when you're too long with a painting, then you have to back off because you can't see it anymore, and especially by this. Yeah.
It's also like a philosophical question, you know, to ask yourself maybe.
Yes.
About the reflection and the. Yeah. The next one I wanted to ask you about is in honor of Morandi. Do you have that near you?
Honor of Morandi. Yeah, I think that's a monotype print. I can't show you here.
Okay, we'll show it on the screen.
Yeah, and because if you know Morandi with his famous bottles.
No, I don't. That's why I wanted to. That's why I wanted to ask you about it.
Yeah, it's a painter, and he paints like impressionists, but also half realistic, half abstract. Hmm. And it's his team, his favorite team is bottles. He also has trees, but the repetition of the bottles and the tall ones, the small ones, the jars, the old-fashioned coffee pots, and the colors are really stunning. Mm. It's like the colors are there, but it's not like it's screaming to you. Mm. It's very
subtle.
Yeah, subtle. Mm. That's the word. Mm. Yeah.
Where was he from, Morandi? Could be Italian or Spanish or French. Or...
Italian.
Mm-hmm. No. Because Italians like glassworks a lot. I don't know if you've ever been to Venice.
No, it's on my list.
Yeah, the Venetian glass up there.
Yeah,
beautiful. The third one is not a painting. It's called, it's one of your jewelry designs. It's called Boho Chic.
Boho Chic, yeah. I can't show you that.
Oh, we'll show it again on the screen.
Yeah, you have to show it on the screen because, you know, it's sold out, and I always make prototypes first. So I will keep the prototypes, but the next line is the Boho Chic bracelets.
Ah.
So it's lace and embroidery.
Mm-hmm.
And with a medium, I made it like it's hard. It doesn't break. It stays a little bit flexible, but it's nice, so I can present it and... Mm-hmm. Just put it like this.
Yeah, beautiful.
Sure. Yeah.
Just going through your chronology. In 2008, you co-founded an art group called Morvan Artistique. So, what is the idea behind the initiative?
That was when we moved to France and we were living in the countryside. So. You know, in the countryside, you need to organize life yourself. Mm-hmm. There is, we had like 1 hectare of land around the house, and the neighbors were not so nearby.
Mm-hmm.
And we had to drive to a little town to do shopping. So there were some artists, and I met them at the exhibition. And then we said, oh, wouldn't it be nice to have a group together so we can meet, and each time we meet, like every 2 months or whatever, in the studio of another artist.
Right.
So we said, yeah, that's a good idea. So we started with the three of us, and you know, suddenly we thought, well, yeah, we have to make like an association. That's like how you call it,
like a club
association. Yeah.
Association.
Yeah, so we can go as an association to exhibit together, and sometimes work together. So,
sure.
And then it still exists. So that was in 2008. I was one of the founders and two other artists. And now we have like 20 members. But we said in the beginning, not more than 20. And we also said, we agreed together, like we have Dutch artists, French artists, Belgian artists, and English artists. So it's like a multi-culti association. So it still exists, but you know, I moved more than an hour from the countryside. So I said, I said, I will let you go, because when I went out of the association, another artist could take my place.
Sure.
That was the deal.
Yeah.
So I said, well, I'm not longer able to exhibit with you because it's too far away or whatever. And I want to see what I can do in La Charité-sur-Loire here in this little town.
And as a matter of fact, then in 2000, or already in 2009, you also started a workshop called, I don't know where this is, but this is a workshop in France, no?
Yes, it's a cultural center. It was a cultural center. We started that in 2009. And we traveled a lot, and we thought, well, we had a big like farmhouse we renovated. And from the barn we made like a big huge studio with a small restaurant downstairs and a kitchen, and upstairs like a loft for the painters. There was a stage. So after the renovation, we started with a friend of us from Spain. He's a very good portrait painter. And we were talking about this idea to start a cultural center to invite teachers to teach whatever. There was also a teacher who thought French language.
So people can come in their summer holidays and they can spend a couple of weeks or something. And how did that go?
It was so nice, because we traveled around, but then we settled down, and then people came traveling.
You.
That's
great.
And that was great, from all over the place, like from India, from Dubai, from Switzerland, from the States, from Scotland, you name it, they came, and they came in the middle of nowhere in France.
Sure.
Yeah.
Do you still run the workshop now, or is it finished? Or
After 10 years, we said, okay, this is enough, and we moved to La Charité.
Yeah.
So we had one year they came here, or 2 years. One or 2 years. But then we said, okay, 10 years, that's fine.
Yeah.
And I wanted to work for myself. I had a boutique. So getting older.
It's called Art de Loire, no?
Yeah, Art en Loire. So I said, okay, you can't do everything at the same moment. So after 10 years doing this cultural center, which was marvelous to meet all these people from everywhere with different backgrounds. So, you know, people normally didn't became friends, but through a week of painting or painting, French language, they met each other. They had a common thing.
Yeah, a connection.
A connection. And after 1 week, they didn't want to go. Want to go home. Yeah.
Well, if you ever feel nostalgic about this kind of experience, then you and Bas can come and run the hotel in Barcelona.
Yeah.
you're welcome. So, and, let's go back to, I think we can call the, also Bas back onto the screen if we like. Come on, Bas. Right. So Bas already mentioned NFT, because for people that don't, that haven't seen it, we made an NFT on the MADinART platform for one of the paintings that that Bas made. Agnes, what about you? Do you like the concept of NFTs? What do you think about the whole new movement?
It's for me, it's really new, but I can see the potential, and I can see the platform for artists, and it's amazing what you can do with technique to make from a painting something else, but you know, it's still a relation between the original painting. Mm-hmm. I think it's great, you know. Mm-hmm. It's new. It's I think it's very good for the artist as well.
Yeah,
yeah. To have a platform.
An evolution of technology in art.
Technology.
What about you, Bas? Did you like your NFT? I mean, they made a few enhancements. What do you think of it?
I liked it a lot. Mm-hmm. As I explained in the latest interview, and because you can do all sorts of things, and then they move the background, and the light of the logo shines on Charles, and I like that a lot. And what's also very nice is it's a unique object. It's a digital unique thing, which makes it very, very special.
Mm-hmm. If you had to, Agnes, if you thought about making NFTs, did you already select one particular piece of art that you would like to make, turn into an NFT, or?
Yeah, I thought about it, but you know, it's with my eyes, maybe it's better to have the eyes of the technicians who's gonna make an NFT, because sometimes they think that one is more suitable than the other one. Mm-hmm. And I don't have a real clue. I think myself, something like I did with the aquarelle, the ink, the red one.
Because what's,
I don't know.
Because what's interesting is that because you make your you make your art also like with a mix of materials, like a media mix. And digital art is like another media. So I thought maybe you would be of a creative mind to think of like completely new things, you know, also.
Yeah, everything is possible. Or that one. Mm-hmm. You know.
And then this can start moving. You can have that hand.
Yeah, I don't know what they can. It's also, you know, I let them free to decide which one is more suitable.
Yes, but from what I understand, once you have a digital image, you can basically do whatever you like. You know, you can make it move in any direction or any color or any shape that you want. So,
yeah, it's amazing, huh?
Yeah, I guess for you guys, It's
I appreciate this art form, because all the museums were closed. They are still closed, but they will open up. Mm. So you miss art, and then the digital art, it's logic. Yeah. I can see now that it's logic to make a platform.
Mm. It like came this. Exactly at the right time because of the pandemic, yeah. Also.
Yeah.
So you can make cool. An exhibition with
screens.
With screens.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Well, we have a vague idea to do something like this in the hotel. I think maybe you are coming.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Yeah.
In July,
exactly. Everything goes well. Last question. What is in the future for Bas and Agnes in the art world, apart from NFTs? What are you going to do? What projects do you have?
I have too many projects.
I have busy, not... busy lady.
Yeah, you know, I have my boutique, so I make things for the boutique. I have my studio, and it's open every Wednesday for my pupils, for my students. And I like to create a new series. I'm always busy to create. If it's maybe a painting or a jewelry or, you know, I have people who are ordering like 30 porte serviettes. It's like a little bag where you can put your napkin in. Yeah. It's old chic from the Burgundy castles and chateaus.
Yeah.
No. And so
you have to mass produce almost.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So and so things will come on my way, and I never have a blackout. Mm. I'm so happy that I can go on, and yeah.
The art keeps flowing.
I don't know. I don't know what's coming on my...
What's coming next, yeah. What about you, Bas? Anything in the pipeline?
Yeah, I have two commissions. Mm-hmm. So that's... But I can't tell anything about it because that's a sort of a secret thing.
Sure.
But and then I just keep painting portraits and objects, a few ideas, but
and maybe some more NFTs down there in the future.
Yeah, why not?